which symbolizes the pinnacle of speed on water, the most demanding and dangerous motorsport of all. 3,000 horsepower gas turbines, 300 kilometers an hour, a track so volatile it can reduce a race boat to matchsticks in the fraction of a second. The sport? Unlimited hydroplane racing. And this, the ultimate prize. The brainchild of His Excellency Sheikh Hassan bin Jaber Al Thani, the Oryx Cup has enjoyed spectacular success in the natural amphitheatre of Doha's stunning bay. And as with any motorsport, the Oryx Cup is more than merely a trophy. There are winners, there are losers. Always high-octane danger. Sweat, tears, and incessant drama. 2009, J. Michael Kelly pulling off a dramatic victory after Steve David's breathtaking somersault. Jeff Bernard's dice was disaster. And Dave Vilwalk's fateful fireworks on the final lap.
To find myself number one in the world, you know, it's a dream come true.
2010, Vilwalk thought he'd blown his chances again, this time in the heats, but came back sensationally to snatch a dramatic win from an outside lane in the final.
To race for an entire country, an entire people, to have that honor and responsibility at the same time was what drove me to I'm a little choked up. It drove me to a new place.
And last year, after all the big guns that successfully reached the shootout, three then went off early, served their sentence, and Scott Lidicote left town with the booty.
It's been an awesome weekend. It's had its highs and lows, but it ended really well.
So to the 2012 title. The world's 10 fastest men on water are back in Doha and will qualify through four grueling heats to determine who will contest Saturday's final. Early hiccup in the proceedings, though. Predicted high winds tomorrow, bringing the time trials plus the heats 1, 2 and 3 forward by 24 hours, meaning it's jam-packed action in the twilight as the sun sets on day one. Oh boy, Oberto Steve David comes into the weekend leading the USA National High Points Championship, of which this is also the final round, by the way. But Qatar driver Vilwalk reduces that to 632 points, setting the fastest time in qualifying. And then...
better than to say.
Vilwalk has been disqualified from Heat 1A for a fuel violation, and a win for David in Heat 1B pushes his lead back up to 1,012 points.
They're saying our low pressure flow is over, but they sent out all the equipment to get recalibrated. Our high pressure flows are fine. Their data didn't work in the first session this morning, so they had to give us new cables, and their box didn't work in the next session. Now they're saying that we're over in fuel.
We monitor every boat with a flow meter, and we monitor the low pressure flow. The fuel flow must not exceed 4.1 gallons per minute.
Vilwalk is then disqualified from Heat 2A for hitting several turn buoys in a fit of pique. His boat is damaged and chances of an Oryx final are diminishing. A bad day just got worse.
They didn't give us enough time to get from the trailer to the water. Just plain and simple. We waited for the cranes. We let the other boats get in because we always wait. I don't know what happened.
I cannot delay the race for one boat, so he gets in. All the other boats were allowed to get into that heat. Several made it, some didn't.
Dark day for Qatar team, and to compound the issue, David achieves his national high points target in Heat 2B, finishing ahead of Shane and Zimmerman, giving him an unsustainable lead and no sympathy for Wilcox's woes.
Do you have any sympathy at all with them?
No.
With Vilwalk unable to make the start of Heat 3A and in seriously compromised light, a darkness to you and me, Steve David, oh boy, Oberto, leads from Kit Brown, Miss Red Dot, J. Michael Kelly, Beacon Plumbing, and Mark Evans, Formula Boats. David extending his advantage throughout the race to win his third heat of the day.
3, 2, 1.
The sun eventually sets during Heat 3B. Racing by instinct, there's a classic scrap between Jimmy Shane, Graham Trucking, and Brian Perkins, U88. Rubbing paint all the way, Shane prevailing in the end by just a couple of roosters. John Zimmerman, Jones Racing, trails in third. Tom Thompson, Peterson May is fourth. Ryan Mallow, U100, is forced out halfway. But no doubt, who's man of the day?
3 heat wins a day, it locks in the national championship for us. It's our 4th team national championship and my 6th driver's title, and you can't happen without a team, though. It's not just the drivers, you see, it's everybody working together to make it happen. So this is a huge celebration for my 13,000 owners back in Madison, Indiana. This is a cool day.
Back to the Oritz Cup now then, and leaderboard at the end of day one. Steve David over the bar at the top. Dave Vilwatt dropping off the bottom and relying on one very slim last chance saloon. Just 2 heats and a final left then. Vilwatt goes into the second heat. This is the first. It's day two. Your lineup is Steve David, U6. In form, Brian Perkins, U88. Kit Brown, U17. J. Michael Kelly, U37. And Mark Evans, U57. Countdown to 0, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go! J. Michael Kelly on your right, David alongside him, then it's Brown, Perkins and Evans heading into the critical turn one, over 250 kilometres an hour. Pulling around, 3G, Kit Brown, third. Steve David there on his left is second. But both trailing this man, J. Michael Kelly, 2009 Oritz Cup winner. Under investigation, though, for jumping the start. Under pressure, too, here from Steve David, and picking him off easily on the back straight. You saw there. Oh boy, Oberto, at the sharp end once more. 3 wins out of 3 this weekend. And with arguably his biggest Oritz Cup threat, Dave Vilwatt, and likely to make tomorrow's final. Big opportunity here for the Madison man to go all the way and become the first driver to hold both national high points and Oritz Cup titles in the same year. Pulling away now from Kelly and Brown, Miss Red Dot, he's third. Perkins, 88, is fourth. Evans, Formula Boats, is fifth. Incidentally, the last lap tells us the track is not quite as benign as it looks. Average speed 223.418 kilometres an hour. Some way short of the record here. Vilwatt holds that with an average nearer 240 during qualifying. Back in 2010, that is. Brian Perkins is fourth. Pretty certain that's good enough to see him through to the final if he can hold on to it. One lap to go. Oh boy, it's Oberto holding all the trump cards. As we suspected, J. Michael Kelly has been penalised a lap for jumping the start. Needed a top result to haul himself into the final shootout, and he ain't going to get that now. So hop, skip and a jump for David. It's 4 out of 4, and the dream of the double lives on. Third place for Brian Perkins books his final slot. Kim Brown won't make it, though. A total of 630 points, not good enough. Which means 500 points, the maximum that Vilwatt can now muster, won't be good enough either. It's Heat 4B, the Qatar driver, lane one, racing for pride. Here they go. From the right, Vilwatt, Shane, Zimmerman, Thompson and Evans. Vilwatt number one, more wins than any other H1 driver, and demonstrating why, thundering into the first turn. Jimmy Shane, nose in front, off the start, never going to hold the big man with lane advantage. Pumping up the G's through turn one, slamming down the throttle, stamping his authority on the back straight. Riding with Shane, and not good news for him, ahead of the clock at 0. It's a penalty lap for Graham Trucking. Whoa, and big moment here for Vilwatt. Tossed up, flying high, turn two up to its old tricks. The Qatar man slams. slowing down with a major issue. Oh, the engine appears to be broken from its mount. The fire there too. Shane leads. Zimmerman moves into second. Thompson's third. It's a red flag. Fire spreading. Fire boat on its way. Oh, scary moments here as Dave Vilwatt begins his escape. What a fire. Unclipping the hatch. The rear of the boat engulfed in flames, and terrifying moments here for the nearest and dearest. This is terrible. Always the risk of explosion, but Vilwatt staying until the fire crew arrived, removed the hatch so they could do their job. The brake man. Well, one mighty leap too many. Launched by a rogue wave into two spine-juddering flat landings that may have snapped the drive chain, and then that in turn triggering the fire. One, two, well, three in fact. The engine cowl ripped off by the force, and the fire starts.
I just hit a big groundswell out there and got up in the air and the motor exploded.
How does that happen?
I don't know. I just, you know, when the propeller goes out of the water, the engine goes up on RPM, the blades come out. They were telling me to get out of the boat and get on the rescue boat, but I've been to those movies before. So you know, if you don't get the cowl off, because other people don't know how to get the cowl off, that many times the fire gets much more ferocious inside the boat. So I quickly pulled the pins out, threw them in, and dumped the cowl off, and then the guy did a great job of hitting it with water immediately.
A mess of major proportions. Brand new $250,000 gas turbine engine trashed. And trouble elsewhere too. Thompson also towed in, and a race against time now to make the rerun.
We got a little wet in the turn lining up for the start and got a lot of salt in the motor, so it's not running clean. And we're supposed to go back in the water and rerun that heat at 4 o'clock.
Can you fix that?
We're hoping we can. We're going to put a good wash on the motor, and this Peters and May team does a fantastic job. They worked their butts off all weekend, so we're not giving up now. We'll be there. Thank you.
And so will we. See you in a couple of minutes. Welcome back to Doha, Oryx Cup. Heat 4, rerun, ready to roll. And after all the drama at the first attempt, a bit of an anti-climax this time, I reckon. Just three drivers make the lineup: Mark Evans along with Dave Vilwatt, the absentees, from which you will gather the Peters and May pit crew accomplish their task, and Tom Thompson has made it. Here we go. John Zimmerman on your right, Jimmy Shane in the middle, and really no contest to be fought. Shane carrying over his extra penalty from the first run. Can't win it, but doesn't need to. He will qualify anyway. Same goes for Zimmerman, both with enough points to see them safely through. Slightly different for Thompson. As far as I know, he needs to score something, has to finish. Pressure on him. Down the back straight. Well, contest or not, Jimmy Shane, U5. Graham Trucking determined, it would seem, to give Zimmerman a good run for his money anyway. Throwing it all in. Takes an insane sort of fella, doesn't it, to throw a boat into the turn in that way, given what happened at this spot just 50 minutes ago. Zimmerman up for the challenge. Hits the front again with the help of the inside lane. By the way, any of you out there wondering why Shane didn't cut across to that inside lane on the back straight? The rules are specific. You must have a lead of at least two rooster tail lengths before doing so. That rule strictly enforced. Over 3 kilometres an hour difference between them in qualifying. Shane at 227.294 kilometres an hour. Clear advantage of 5.090 over Zimmerman. And that beginning to show now. Thundering exit there from Shane. Turn one, lap two, providing the required two roosters. Should be able to cruise in from here. Extra penalty lap, so he can't win. But Zimmerman with a little bit to ponder now before they face up again in that final shootout. Different ball game, but Shane is up for the cup, no doubt about that. It's a great run in the setting sun. Not quite good enough with that penalty to take the 400 points. In the end, just a third behind Tom Thompson, who hit his target too. So let's get an update now on that earlier incident when Dave Vilwatt's Oryx ambition finally went up in smoke. Eric Elstrom giving Sheikh Hassan the lowdown. Earlier I asked the crew chief where it leaves the team now.
You know, the more we dig in, the more we find. We got our wiring harnesses. We run three sets of harnesses in the boat so we can just quick change them. And they're all melted together, so we actually have to cut it out of the boat. There's more delamination because of the heat. We've got some busted air traps. Sponson tips are broken. There's just more and more damage. So there's just more and more work that we're going to have to do.
So, what chance of making the next round in just 24 days?
The boat is hurt worse than it's ever been hurt before. And being so far from the shop, a lot of stuff that we have there and the molds we have there to build parts are there. We've already been in contact with the shop to get the molds down, so if we have to build stuff to fly it here. But it just don't know the answer yet.
Oh, could this be the answer? A little Scandinavian magic.
Okay, this one is a 1-6 scale hydroplane. The hull is made from carbon fiber. Some gimmicks on this boat are a working front canard. It's mixed up with a throttle channel, so when you go on the throttle, it goes up like the real ones. The skid fin area is the same as the big boats. We try to copy all the details with the bracking, the skid fin, and the holders. The rudder turns left and right to the like the real ones. We even had some lights in the exhaust pipe made from LEDs. This boat is electric powered. We have an engine in that makes up to 15 horsepower. It's loaded up with batteries with 42 volts and up to 500 amps. So this makes a speed of around 75 miles per hour.
May struggle getting Vilwalk in the cockpit, of course. Time to move on, and the lineup for the shootout. The top five make the grid. J. Michael Kelly is the trailer boat. Kip Brown is the first reserve. And here's Steve David.
We've had a fantastic weekend here in Doha. We've won all four heats, and now if I can just pull off this final, we will have won the national championship and the world championship. So this will be a tremendous weekend for Madison, Indiana, and the Oboy Alberto.
I think everybody's going to be strong out there. Everybody's going to obviously be running hard for the Works Cup. We're hoping to be out there in front with in front of everybody.
Made as a trailer boat, which, you know, you don't always want to go into a final as a trailer, but I've been there before. You know, can always try to pick up positions and stuff like that. Got to start 5 seconds behind the rest of the guys. So, you know, at the same time, it's kind of fun, though, because you get to see what you can do, see if you can drive through the field and see what you can get.
Right then, grab the edge of your seats, take a deep breath. It's time for the Oryx Cup final. Counting down to the 1 minute mark, at which point maneuvering for a position will cease. Lane held becomes your grid position for the race at that point. It's like two starts. There it is. Jimmy Shane just squeezing into lane one in the nick of time you saw there on that mark. That's a crucial first step.
49 seconds. We want to beat that entry probably about 20. Our check's going to be 8.
Steve David in lane two is the second phase of the start. The all-important run to the line gathers momentum. Hit it before 0 seconds, remember, carries a penalty lap. Cat and Max once again in gathering gloom here in Doha as the sun sets. Is anyone brave enough to take the line flat out? Get it right and you can win from lane five. Get it wrong and you're buried. J. Michael Kelly as trailer boat starts 5 seconds behind the front line, turning into the straight ahead of the start. 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go! Shane on the right, David on the left.
Run down there, bud, you gotta get him.
Steve David's pit crew there.
Try to catch him.
Brian Perkins and John Zimmerman outside him. Thompson has problems. The start is clean. Scintillating Shane through the first 1,000 meters, taking the early grip. David with work to do. Now in the back straight, 285 kilometers an hour, 100 meters every second.
Disqualified.
Oh, disqualification. That's Jimmy Shane they're referring to.
Keep back after it. There's a confusion here.
Well, what is that all about? Start definitely clean, so it can't be that. Confusion. Steve David moves up. He and John Zimmerman both have the message. Still not clear what is going on, though.
Yeah, we got to run him down. He's legal. Got a rooster tail on us, though.
Oh, well, that just about clears it up. Short and sweet, mistaken identity. It's J. Michael Kelly who's got the chop. Ignoring officials' requests to leave the inside lane on the start run, we're told. Well, 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 that's a pity. And oh, there he is, returning to the dock, empty-handed. Started an enforced 5 seconds behind the rest as trailer man. Guess he thought he'd have a punt. Not much to lose back there, to be perfectly honest. Anyway, he's gone. Onus back on Steve David for a couple of seconds. He must have thought Christmas had come early.
Yeah, but it was a 37, it was penalized, not the 5. We've got to go get him. He's slowing down a little bit. Let's keep chasing him.
Six-lap race, 3 and a bit minutes left to catch Jimmy Shane, pass him, and lift the Oryx Cup for the first time. Zimmerman playing spectator, 5 kilometres an hour slower than both David and Shane in qualifying. Hopes really resting on an inside lane at the start. Well, he didn't get that, and now over 2 seconds adrift of Steve David in second. No joy either for Peters and May. Tom Thompson's brave effort to get to this final won't be rewarded with the podium unless, oh well, you know the rest. Anything can happen in this sport. Let's check out the speed. Shane average 218.724 kilometres an hour. David 220.103.
Have to go again. Keep pushing on him.
Gently reeling him in. The High Point champion 2005, 6, 8, 9 and 2010 versus Shane the rookie first season. Quite a fairy story, whichever way the coin drops. Shane, still hot favourite, of course. Zimmerman to 116.004, holding his pace, holding his place. Fingers crossed, the two ahead might just bust one another, but not very likely. But you never know. Brian Perkins, fourth, dropping back also. Nothing left in his kitty. Second at the Tri-Cities, Washington in 2008, and third in Seattle 2010. A talented driver, but never quite on the pace this weekend. As Jimmy Shane up ahead there in clear water, up the stakes. Last lap, 220.448 kilometres an hour. David responds, 221.192, edging closer, but needs to do even more. One lap after this, 50 seconds. One hazardous home straight, driving blind into the setting sun. One back straight and two raking corners. 2 kilometres stand between Jimmy Shane and his Graham trucking machine and the coveted Oryx Cup trophy. Steve David hot on his heels there, still edging up. Pulses racing as they do. One tiny error, one mechanical gremlin could change everything. Remember 2009, Phil Watt lost everything on the last lap with a turbine malfunction. 700 metres to go. Tom Thompson moves out of the way. Steve David, one last gasp effort. Shane into Mark 2 for the final time. Whoa, but he too, almost doing a full walk there for a second. Intrepid till the last. Through the turn of terror, into the home straight. Steve David won't get in from there. Jimmy Shane wins the Oryx Cup after dominating from the start, trucking down the freeway to become the fourth different winner in 4 years. For Steve David, the wait must go on. John Zimmerman filling the third podium spot, but nothing, of course, for Perkins or Thompson. Well, happy days at Graham Trucking and a hero's homecoming coming up any second. Trouncing one of the sport's all-time greats in the process.
I guess if that's the worst I call you, I'm still doing pretty good.
Great job, man. Great job.
Jimmy, hell of a race, man.
Good job.
There's got to be an element of disappointment about this. Is it fight another day?
Sure, absolutely. We come back in February and do our best.
Yeah. Yeah. You got the number one on your boat next year.
Absolutely, and that's pretty cool. Yeah.
Jimmy, how about that?
Hey, that was fantastic, you know. Couldn't ask for a better race, you know. Had a good start, got clear out in front, and was able to drive my own race once I got out in front, so that helped out a lot.
You said it would be pretty good.
Yeah,
I didn't fail now.
I'll tell you what, man, this is amazing to be over here in this country and to be doing the stuff that we do here with the H1 series and the Air National Guard. It's amazing. It's just, it's kind of speechless. I'll tell you what, man, it's crazy.
A tale of two titans, one attempting but unable to hide his bitter disappointment, the other barely able to contain his excitement. That's racing. And so, a great weekend in the world capital of powerboating comes to an end, and not without its controversy and drama. But then, this is the Oryx Cup after all. See you next time.
I've gone through life white-knuckling the moments that left me behind. Refusing to heed the yield, I penetrate the force fields in the blind. They say I'll adjust, God knows I must, but I'm not sure how. This natural selection picked me out to be a dark horse running in the fantasy. And I'm running out of time. Flesh and bone. Somewhere outside that finish line, I square up and break through the chains. And I hit like a raging bull.
I don't know what to say. I don't know how to describe that today.
And they'll call me the contender. Listen for the bell, with my face flashing crimson from the fires of hell.
Huge celebration for my 13,000 owners back in Madison, Indiana. This is a cool day.
Kind of speechless. It's, I'll tell you what, man, it's crazy.